Hey, it's good to be with you this morning. Let's continue to just dive deeper into what the Lord has for us. You know, as Pastor Steve was sharing up there, it just makes me think, you know, I know the histories of, you know, spiritual parents revival stories, and I think about it like I was there, even though I definitely was not. but I was just thinking about a story that I heard from Pastor Steve and Cindy, how in Canada, Ashley told me that there was a heating vent in front of the sink in the kitchen, and the kids liked to sit there because the floor was warm. Did anybody ever have a heating vent that was warm in the winter that you'd go to in the morning, like half asleep, and stand there while you're eating your breakfast or your coffee? Anyways, you know, I just saw this picture of them from when they were, you know, 27 years ago or whatever it was, when the Lord was speaking to them about coming back from Canada to Cleveland. And what a risk that must have felt like in the natural. But I'm just so grateful that we have a senior pastor who is never afraid to take the risk when the Lord is in it. And I think about that, yes, that maybe, I don't know if it happened on the kitchen floor right there, but that, yes, what has materialized 27 years later from that, I don't know if they could have had any conceptualized idea of what would happen just by saying yes to coming back here. And we're sitting in this building and we're a part of what the Lord is doing here today because somebody said yes. Somebody took their kids, moved here without a job. Well, he had a job, but, you know, planted a church. and here we are together. And I want to challenge you today, as we're coming together, a poverty mindset thinks that only big, important people have yeses that matter. But the kingdom mindset will teach you that it's that what you see in the big scope, what you see in this building, what you see in Pastor Steve and Cindy, is an indicator of what God will do with your yes if you give it to him. And so I want to encourage you, as we're coming together, this is so much more than just a physical move or, like, you know, switching real estate or bringing people in. This is orienting into the promise and purposes of God for what he wants to do. Right? Someone's calling me. Is that Pastor Steve? God? No, it's spam. Okay. I thought the only person who would call me right now is Pastor Steve. He wants to get the story straight. Okay. Oh, gosh. But obviously, last week, Pastor Steve, and in that video, shared about the launch of Come Together, where all of our campuses, well, the Middleburg Heights and the Brunswick, are coming together into one powerful community. Akron's continuing on. And as Steve mentioned, I just want to say we're completely blown away by the positive responses and the excitement and the faith. I mean, phones were blowing up all week with people saying, we're here, we're with you, we're ready for this. And we feel that, and we value that, and it means the world. You know, speaking about some of the history here about the Brunswick property, just some of the words that the Lord has given us. Anybody ever heard of a guy named Bob Jones? Prophet, passed away on Valentine's Day. I think there was an earthquake. passed away a couple years ago. Well, Pastor Steve had a friendship with Bob Jones, and he took him on the property here many years ago. And when Bob came out, you may have heard this story before. I just want to remind you. Bob stepped out, and I can't do a really great Bob Jones impression. I'm told my wife does a really good one when she's prophesying. but you know, I just picture Bob, because I only met him once, and the only time I ever talked to him is he was prophesying to the staff, and he told the staff, he said, looked at me, he goes, you're very smart. And the staff goes, I'm kidding, not that bad. and he talked about writing, which is materializing in my life. But anyways, Steve took Bob Jones on the property, and he steps out, and he goes, this is Jacob's field. And, you know, of course, Steve, he leans over and with respect says, well, no, Bob, that's downtown Cleveland. That's Jacob's field. This is the Brunswick property. He goes, no, this is Jacob's field. And he pointed around the property. He said he saw thousands of young people flooding these grounds. He said that he saw people lined up on the outside with the fences along the freeway, that he saw people lined up across the fences trying to climb over the fences to get onto this property. And I was thinking about the prophetic history of this place. You know, there's a video that's, I'd use the word iconic, but it's huge for us as a church. Pastor Steve was with Heidi Baker, who's coming just next week. Is that already happening? Oh my gosh. I didn't realize that till just this moment. I thought we had like 3 weeks before that. Anyways, Heidi is coming again on Wednesday, and we're so excited that she's here. But they took a video of, Steve took a video of Heidi, and she was prophesying about Cleveland, and she said that it was time to push. She said that the Lord was about to bring thousands and thousands of people, souls, into the kingdom. And I want to remind you, this year, even I think it was just about like 6 months ago, we had a dear friend of ours, Tommy Zito, here, and we took our teams out into the streets, and we were able to expose over 500 people to the gospel, and they prayed with us. And we believe that's a foretaste of what the Lord is about to do in Cleveland. It's like the Jesus people movement, right? People, I hear it was easy. Someone sneezed and someone got saved. You know, the Lord was just moving, and we're just believing. We're believing for that again. We're believing for God to be, move in power and to bring resurrection and to call the lost home, to call the prodigals home. And I think that what challenges us about evangelism is it, I've said this before, but evangelism confronts our unbelief. And so we get nervous because we have to confront, do we believe that the gospel alone, not our delivery, not our charisma or our personality, but the message of the gospel is powerful enough for someone to be saved and resurrected? That it doesn't need me to be fancy or to say it a certain kind of way, but the gospel alone is powerful enough that if you wield it in your hand, people will respond to it. People get saved, or like one time when I was at Meijer, they might want to punch you in the face. That happens. That's okay too. But it's time. We couldn't be more excited for what God's about to do. And we felt the stirring of God's Spirit moving, uniting, and equipping this house for the days ahead, for what the Lord's about to do. I love this room, this corner of the room. I'm just going to come over and preach over to this corner, over to you guys. No, okay, no. So I just wanted to update you on just a couple of practical things. This week, our ministry leaders and various staff leaders of departments are all planning intentional one-on-one connections with everyone on Middleburg Heights ministry teams and ministries affected by the transition, as well as gathering all of those teams together within the next 6 to 8 weeks. Now, we're also coming up with a strategy to make sure that each person at the Middleburg Heights campus gets a personal touch and that this place is ready to receive them. And, you know, the most important component of their reception is going to be, it's you. You guys are going to be, yeah, and he was like, yes, you're the most important part to embrace and welcome them here, because we need each other and we need you. You know, Pastor Steve called me this week, and he was on the phone talking about how he was reaching out to individual couples. Now, he's going on this very long ministry trip. It's going to be a lot of travel, a lot of work, and he's doing some incredible things, but he made it a priority to be reaching out to people individually that he really thought that he needed to. And he said, Jay, we've got to go after people. This isn't the time to just kind of see what happens. This is the time for us to raise up as leaders in the ministry, for you guys to raise up as influencers in this community and go after people and make sure that they know you're supposed to be here, you have a place here, and we're coming for you. In a good way. So this is the time to find your place. Now's the time to get some skin in the game. If you could just wave at me for a second, who is a volunteer here? Thank you for waving without the rest of it. That was good. I like that. If you volunteer, that's amazing. We love you. We appreciate you. Guys, now's the time to have skin in the game here. Now's the time to make your marks, get some ownership. And so if you aren't volunteering, if there is an area of ministry that you've been passionate about that maybe you haven't explored, now's the time to do it. The Lord is about to breathe on something. This is like, it's like buying low. This is right before everything goes way up into the ceiling. And so now is the time to get invested, to put down roots and to bear fruit in this house. And one of the ways that we do that is through serving. Why? Because serving creates opportunities for us to build authentic community, to have ownership, and to be used by the Lord in powerful ways and build his house. And you know, there's a trend right now where volunteer work, some people feel like it's about trying to get people to do something for you. You know, again, let's confront that poverty mindset. The Lord is going to send the people to do the work. We're not asking people because we're desperate. The Lord is going to provide. We're asking people because this is an amazing place to be involved in. And we know that if you plug in, if you get connected, if you serve, all of heaven's going to open up all over your life. We know it. We've seen it happen over and over and over again. Right after we took up the offering, somebody came over to me and whispered that they just got $7,000 in the mail. I mean, so that was fast, Lord. Maybe retro, but it already happened. So the Lord is moving in this place. And imagine what your yes is going to release in this community. Your full yes. Not the, well, I'll serve in this area and maybe... I might have some availability like once a month to serve in the coffee team. This is about, first of all, cafe team's awesome. I love all my cafe people. I worked in a coffee shop with the mermaid siren for about a decade, so I like coffee too. But what I'm saying is that now is the time to put down roots, not just to show up on a Sunday morning, not just to just come to receive, but to start to invest and allow the Lord to just increase that over and over and over and even more. Yeah? Amen. So open up your Bibles to 1 Peter chapter 2. And we're going to go there. And real quick, I don't know if this is the Lord, so I'm just going to go for it real quick. So I have a friend in the congregation, and she was a professional bodybuilder. If you see her, you'd say, oh yeah, I get that. Anyways, she offered to help like do a meal plan for me because I like to go to the gym a couple times a week. You might not be able to tell, but I'm kidding. But she put me on this. She said you need to be on a meal plan because you know for a lot of years when I would go there, I'm a weird person. I don't like eat breakfast or lunch usually, and so like I'll go to the gym. And I'm like, does it feel normal to feel like nauseous, tired, and like sweaty the whole time? I just thought this was how it was, and you know. My bodybuilding friend who put me on this plan, it's just transformed everything. Because why? Because I'm not going into the gym malnourished anymore. And I think in the body of Christ, sometimes we limp along malnourished. We don't spend time alone with the Lord. We don't invest our lives. We don't serve in the local community, right? And then we wonder why we're struggling. We wonder why we're feeling disconnected. We wonder why maybe we show up on a Sunday and don't know anybody. But the Lord is saying, these doors are wide open for you to know everybody. And it's full of a church who really, really wants to know you. And if you will just invest, if you will feed your spirit and you will feed your soul with community, imagine what the Lord will do in your life. Imagine the breakthrough that'll happen. Imagine what this church would look like. So I want to challenge you. I want to challenge you. Go for it this year, 2024. Don't be malnourished in the spirit of your soul. Spend time with the Lord. Get in the Word and be in this community. Be a part of what the Lord's about to do because it's going to be bonkers. It's going to be amazing. All right, so if you're there, let's dive into it today. I want to talk to you about coming together, but the promise attached to it that when we come together, he will come. And what do we do? How do we treat him when he does come? All right, so let's go into 1 Peter chapter 2. I'm going to start in verse 5. This is the NLT. It says, come and be his living stones who are continually being assembled into a sanctuary for God. For now you serve as holy priests, offering up spiritual sacrifices that he readily accepts through Christ Jesus. Let's jump back down to verse 7. I just have three parts here in this passage that jumped out. It says, as believers, you know his great worth. Just like this morning when we were, worthy is your name, Jesus. We know his worth, or at least the little keyhole that we can take a peek of and take in without exploding. I would assume that maybe we might explode if we saw how worthy he was. But the verse continues on and says, indeed, his preciousness is imparted to you. Did you catch that? It says, you know his great worth and the preciousness of Jesus. The way all of, because you gotta think about this. Heaven isn't just a weird, spalatial diamond in the sky fluff place. It's a real place. It's a real community. There's real people are up there walking around talking. There's a society, and they're watching, and the preciousness of Jesus, all the glory of God, the all of heaven is surrounded and lit up by the preciousness of this man of sorrows. And it says in that word that his preciousness is imparted to you. That because, and it's not because necessarily we are so wonderful or so fantastic or so great. I think we all know that on an honest day, we wouldn't feel that way about ourselves most of the time. But the preciousness is because of the value that we get by the way that Jesus looks at us. The value Jesus has for us. His preciousness and his willingness to die for you and for me is imparted to you. And you're precious to God. Did you hear me? So you can't walk out of this church after this service. You can't walk out of this church after today and walk around saying, well, God doesn't like me very much. I'm not very likable. And I'm just going to walk around in my unworth. Because God is saying right here, it's in the word right here. It says his preciousness is imparted to you. So you don't get to say that. You've got to willfully disregard and ignore what the word of God says you are to be able to walk around feeling like you're less than, because Jesus says that you are his son and his daughter and that he loves you and that his very own preciousness is imparted to you. So you don't get to walk through the world thinking that you're worth nothing or you're this or you're that. You don't get to do that anymore because God says that you are more than that. And so it's not about us trying to measure up to what we're trying to be. It's about allowing the word of the Lord to transform you and your mindset, because yours is the one that's all screwed up. God says that you have the preciousness of Christ. You're precious to him, which means we got to start living like we're precious, right? Verse 9, you are God's chosen treasure. I'm not making this up. This is what it says right there. Precious treasure. You are God's chosen treasure, priests who are kings, a spiritual nation set apart as God's devoted ones. And he called you out of darkness to experience his marvelous light. And now he claims you as his very own. And he did this, say he did this, so that you, okay, you don't have to repeat anymore, would broadcast his glorious wonders throughout the world. He did this so that you would broadcast his glorious wonders throughout the world. Not just sit there quiet and hold it inside of you, but broadcast it. If the Lord gave you $30,000 today, you better believe you'd grab a microphone and you'd be preaching and screaming and saying, I got $30,000. You've got something way more than $30,000. You do. But maybe 30 would be nice, Lord, for some of the people who are over there. Lord, I'm gonna. He did this. He called you his own so that you would broadcast his glorious wonders throughout the world. For at one time, you were not God's people, but now you are. And at one time, you knew nothing of God's mercy because you hadn't received it yet, but now you are drenched with it. So this whole come together moment of our church is more than a physical location, because we are more than a physical location. We're a dynamic community of believers with Jesus at the center. That's who we are. And you are living stones. We're building the walls for a sanctuary and a house for the Lord to visit and touch people for generations to come. I pray that my children and my children's children experience the glory of God in this place. The time of the Spirit is what we're stepping into. Because when we come together, he will come. God is coming and revival is near. Hey, I have something really cool I wanted to show you. It's really quick. It's a video that we're going to pop up on the screen for just a moment here. I'd like to pull up the heaven video. So AI, if you've all seen the Terminator, we're all a little scared of it and Skynet coming on and all that. But AI has this pretty cool thing where if you plug in a verse to it, it's starting to generate images based on the verse. And so people are posting those videos. And I wanted to show you just a brief, it's maybe a 10-second, 5-second clip of what AI says heaven might look like. And then I want to dive into that a little bit, but it's really cool. If we could just pull that up, Irene. What people think versus... Isn't that so cool? That is so cool. Hey, I would like to share something kind of personal with you guys today. Is that all right? I don't have to. I'm kidding. So in 2023, I had a dream. How many of you had a prophetic dream before? You're in the right place. Sorry, it's just funny. Like, we're so characterized by it. It's like normal to us here that God speaks, you know? My family's still just, we're blown away about what the Lord is doing. You know, I even think back before my dream even, it just made me think about my daughter, Josie, who had a dream walking through the school, and she saw this blonde lady who was named Miss Sandra, and she was the new third grade teacher. And the thing is, nobody knew who the third grade teacher was. We made a song up about her. We called her No Name, No Name, no, no, no. Sorry, Miss Kubiak. But we couldn't find the teacher's name, but when we went to orientation that day, Josie walked in, and we found out that the new third grade teacher's name indeed was Sandra. And she was blonde and exactly like it. And she walked into the classroom and we told this teacher about her dream. And the teacher, the power of God, the Spirit of God hit her. And she said, I believe God speaks like this. She said, I've only taught third grade ever. She said, I felt the Lord told me I needed to be at this school. And she said, and then you're walking in this classroom right now and your daughter dreamt and knew my name before she ever met me. And it's just such a confirmation about what the Lord is doing. I wanna tell you, God is gonna speak in new ways in this season. And I've craved encounters from the Lord. I remember when I was in my early 20s in ministry school and I was exposed to the Spirit, like life in the Spirit. I didn't know much about it other than the encounters I had had, crying at the altar and stuff like that. But like, there's more. That's what I thought, there's more for us to see. And I remember I worked at a church. I was custodian back in Youngstown and I was cleaning my way through ministry school. And I remember I would sit there and I would pray and I'd say, Lord, I want to see you. And I'd stare at the hallway and just wait to see it. I wanted to see it. And then I'd get freaked out because, you know, you start to feel like he might actually come and then you just run. Okay. But last year in 2023, I had a dream, and it was, I've had prophetic dreams before. This was different. This was different. This felt very, very real. This felt very, very, very awake, if that makes sense. And I memorized every detail. And I remember walking through the process of this whole dream. And when I woke up, it was like 3 a.m, and I just wrote. Furiously, I just wrote, like scribbled everything down because I didn't want to miss a single detail, because everything, when the Lord speaks and when you start to see things like this, everything has meaning. Everything symbolizes something. It's like the Bible. When God speaks, I think he just can't help it. It unpacks. It's like an onion. It's got so many different layers and so many different meanings and applications. There's so much in it, and you just get the onion in your hand. How can you possibly understand how many intricate, specific layers there are in that? And you don't. It's like you got to unpack it over the years. So I wrote down everything I could, every impression, every emotion, and I'd like to share that with you this morning because I believe in that dream that I got to have a glimpse of what heaven looks like. And so I want to share it with you. So I'm going to share also the prophetic elements of the dream that have already come to pass, because there's a lot of them. So I was walking up and down this beautiful, like, beach, like dune-colored sand. Like, I don't know if you've seen any of the old Dune book covers, like kind of orangey sand. And I'm walking up the beach, and I'm walking with Ashley, and I'm walking with Cindy, and we were discussing how we were going to staff our campuses or, you know, the church on a Sunday morning, because Pastor Steve was in Asia. He was going over to Asia, and Joel was going as well, and I was trying to make a plan to the trip. It wasn't Taiwan, it was Thailand, and I was trying to organize it so that I could. So Ashley was going to preach, so there's your heads up, hun. And as we were walking up and down the beach, the only way I can describe to you is it was like just perfect serenity. I had an encounter with the Lord once where I had a picture of an ocean. I had an encounter with the Lord once where I had the picture of a specific kind of stretch of beach after a dear friend had passed away. And so it holds a special place in my heart. So I'm walking up and down that beach in this dream. And Cindy goes out into the surf, and she turns over and she smiles at me, and she holds up 3 pieces of asparagus, which, if you know her, makes a lot of sense right now. Because she's all about healing your body through food, but also the Spirit of God. It's that perfect mixture happening there. But I looked up what asparagus symbolizes, and get this, this was in 2023. So dreaming about asparagus symbolizes growth and renewal. And it could be a sign that you're ready to make changes in your life or take on new opportunities. It can also symbolize health. So it could be the need to take care of yourself, but that really stuck out to me about making changes, new opportunities, growth and renewal, because I feel like it described us. And I don't think it's an accident that the three asparagus is in her hands and we have three campuses. So she's holding them in her hand up to her mouth. She didn't eat them, don't worry. I remember Ashley and I turned around to kind of look back, and then this is where it gets really cool, and just bear with me. The sky was like outer space, but also a sunrise. So you could see the stars, but it was daylight. And there was just like opalescent colors. It was very strange, a lot of different colors. And we looked up in there and we flew. Like, if you ever had a flying dream before, this was different. This was wild. This was like really fast flying, just kind of like all throughout the sky and then under the water in the ocean and up and top. I mean, I know this might be like trippy for some of you, but it's awesome in the dream. I love flying in my dream. And then all of a sudden we went faster and faster, and then we stopped, and all of a sudden I was in a dark place, and it was kind of a place where like nothing really stays or happens, right? It's sort of like a utility closet or that room you throw your stuff to forget about it in. Like, you go in there and it's storage, and I'm standing there with Ashley. I know we're there. I can feel the breathing, and all of a sudden, something like a door opens and a book gets tossed in, and somebody comes in with the book. And I pick up the book, and I feel like the Lord said that this is Ashley's book that she's going to write, and that the person who came in the room is going to help her to write it. My wife Ashley in the front row are there if you have questions. Brogan, right there. So then the door opens. Stick with me, because this is kind of crazy. I know this might mess with some people, but I remember Corinthians 12, 2, where Paul was talking about, he said, I know a man in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up in the third heaven, whether in the body or out of body, I don't know, but God knows. And the door opened, and we stepped into a courtyard which looked like that video. Like, it was all the way up, and you could see through the ceiling. I thought it was glass, but you could see all the way through it. And Ashley was visible. I could see. It was almost like I was looking from a vantage point, and I could see like 100 people standing there, and Ashley was standing there like this. And the Lord picked me up and just kind of carried me through the air, almost like you were relaxing in somebody's breath, if you could do that. And it took me up, and I entered this sanctuary, and up on the walls was the scripture written, now is the time is coming, and now is the time when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for these are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks, in gold writing on these banners. And then I came back in, and this is where, you know, it was kind of nuts, all of this is nuts. But I went back into the courtyard, and Ashley and everybody else had started to raise up off the ground like a reverse pencil dive, you know, like when you're diving in, but going straight up. And Ashley turned around, and I could see her eyes, and they looked like waves in water. And she looked over, and she said, the time of the Spirit has come. And so then in the dream, I woke up in bed next to her. I was still dreaming, and I could hear her thoughts in the dream. Like, and I remember hearing her thinking, because if you haven't heard, I think it would be hard for anyone in this room not to know. Ashley's been having a powerful encounter with the Lord over the past couple years in the Word and in the glory of God, just really heavy visitation. She was laying in bed thinking, Lord, is it over? Is it a pause? What's going on here? And it felt like the Lord said, you need to wake her up and tell her about this dream. So then I woke up in real life, and I woke her up. And she wasn't happy about it at first, you know, being woken up. And I told her the whole dream, and I don't remember much, because Ashley goes, how am I supposed to go to sleep after hearing this? And I said, I don't know, my assignment's done. And I went straight to and I went straight back to sleep. And, you know, and I felt like the time of the Spirit has come for this church, for this moment, for this city. It's coming. I believe the people in that dream and that we're going to rise in the Spirit are you. And that the time of the Spirit has come, that when we come together, He will come. And I just had one thought that I want to dig into here. I'm going to unpack kind of quickly for you. So just hang on, buckle up, and let's go. I felt like when I was thinking about the Lord coming, I felt like the Holy Spirit asked me, but do you know how to treat me when I come? Do you know what to do when I come? Because, you know, historically, every church, we spend a lot of time preparing for his arrival, don't we? From a tent in the wilderness, to Solomon building the temple in Jerusalem, to the Lord making our physical bodies his resting place, right? We spend a lot of time preparing for his arrival. But when we come together and he comes, what a miracle that is. I want to kind of, 1 Corinthians 2, you don't have to go there. I just want to explain this real quick about the miracle of his spirit in us. Listen, it says that, There we go. All right, verse 11 of 1 Corinthians 2, it says, "For what man knows the things of man except the spirit of a man which is in him?" And what does that mean? Pause there for just a second. It means that all of us, all of you here today, when you have a thought, when you have an impression or a reaction to something in your life or to something somebody has done to you, you edit before it comes out your mouth. Nobody really knows what you're thinking. And I think a lot of us, you know, if we have an external mentality, sometimes we will process and say the appropriate thing because our emotions aren't in line with it yet, but we're going to process and move forward correctly, right? And there's discipline to that. But my point in that is it says that what man knows the things of that person except the spirit which is in him. No one's ever really going to know exactly what you think unless you are just like wording it out, every thought without a filter, and then we'll pray for you after for that too. Discernment, Lord. But nobody knows what's going on except the spirit of a man which is in him. Now let's continue. It says, "Even so, no one knows the things of God except the spirit of God." So get that. In the same way that you alone know what you think and feel, nobody else can really ever know that space except God. That personal, your spirit actually knows what's going on. It says that nobody can know the things of God except the spirit of God, which is in God, right? And so now listen to this. It says in verse 12, "We have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit who is from God, that we might know the things that have been freely given to us by God." So do you get that? So in the same way, it would be as though you take your spirit that shows all your vulnerabilities, how you actually think and feel, the purest version of you, and you give it to somebody else. And now they know exactly how you think, exactly how you feel, and exactly who you are. They see it all. That is what God has done for you. He has taken his spirit that knows the things of God that existed for all of eternity in the Trinity, and he's given it to you so that you would know the things of God, so that you would know how God thinks, how God moves, what motivates him, that you'd be able to come into a greater alignment with his spirit. He gives you his spirit. Can you imagine the level of security and confidence you would have to do? Because I feel like I'd want to do some edits on my spirit before I gave it to somebody else. Let them know exactly what I'm thinking. I'm like, "Lord, can I give them like the sheltered version of that?" God doesn't give an edited version of himself. He gives you all of him. Right? That's the miracle of his spirit in you, is that you can know how God moves, thinks, operates. What a miracle that is. So everybody else in the world stumbling around in the dark, blind. But you have the spirit of God in you. The author, the one who holds the fabric of the universe together, the one who spoke everything in. You know what he thinks. He's given you his spirit. What a miracle. And if we're not careful, what a miracle we get used to, we get comfortable with. And I've been asking the Lord a lot lately, we've been writing a song about it, saying, "Lord, I don't want to treat you as common. Don't let me get used to your name." Come on. The miracle of the Spirit in you. When we come together, he will come. We're about to experience his Spirit in a new way. And do we know how to treat him when he comes? So let's dig into somebody in the Bible who did not do it well. Exodus chapter 9. Let's talk about Mount Sinai. So I want you to break down and read this later, okay? Because I'm kind of running out of time and I got to bring it in for a landing, but I want you to get this before I go. So If you jump into verse 1, it's talking about 3 months after Israel's gone out from Egypt, when they get to the wilderness of Sinai. And so the Lord is calling Moses up to the mountain saying, okay, you've seen what I did to the Egyptians. Now, if you will indeed obey my voice, keep my covenant, you'll be a special treasure to me above all people, for all the earth is mine. And you'll be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words which you shall speak to the children of Israel. So Moses, 3 months fresh out of the sea splitting, walks into that in front of Israel, and he presents this. The Lord's promise to make them a holy priesthood and a holy nation if they will follow what he says. And they respond saying, all the Lord has spoken, we will do. And so then the Lord said to Moses, I'm going to come to you in a thick cloud that the people may hear when I speak to you and believe you forever. So if we hop down to verse 16, it says, it came to pass on the third day in the morning, there were thunderings and lightnings and a thick cloud on the mountain. And the sound of a trumpet was very loud, so that all the people who were in the camp trembled. And Moses brought the people out of the camp to meet with God, and they all stood at the foot of the mountain. And Sinai was completely in smoke, because the Lord had descended upon it in fire. Its smoke ascended like the smoke of a furnace, and the whole mountain quaked greatly. And when the blast of the trumpet sounded loud and became louder and louder, Moses spoke, and God answered him by voice. And then God came down on Mount Sinai on top of the mountain, and the Lord called Moses to the top of the mountain, and Moses went up. I have an AI-generated image of what they think Sinai looked like. Can we play that and check it out? You climbing that mountain? You gonna walk up into that? We'd have people here today be like, I know God said it was on a mountain, but man, that's a volcanic eruption. That's gonna be like, you know, that's not gonna be a good thing. That's ash. That's lightning. What's going on up there? So Moses is up there with God, and God is speaking to him. And you read through all of Exodus. Maybe it reads a little bit different if you had that image in front of your face, that that's what Moses is sitting in with God while he's getting the Ten Commandments and all of the information about what to do next. But if we hop over to Exodus chapter 32, in verse 1, this is where I want to land. It says, when the people saw that Moses delayed coming down from the mountain, the people gathered together to Aaron, who was the priest, and he said, come, make us gods that shall go before us, for this Moses, the man who brought us out of the land of Egypt, we don't know what's happened to him. And Aaron says, break off all the gold earrings in the ears of your wives, your sons, your daughters, and bring to me. And I want to remind you that when the Israelites escaped Egypt, they plundered it on the way out. And it specifically says that the Egyptian women gave up all their gold and jewelry to the Israelites. So it's likely that this jewelry that they're bringing to Aaron in this moment is the spoils of victory from what the Lord had done when he brought them out of Egypt. Okay? And so all the people broke off the earrings that were in their ears and brought them to Aaron. And he received the gold, and he fashioned it with an engraving tool and made a molded calf. And they said, this is your God, O Israel, that brought you out of the land of Egypt. Now, here's the thing. Idolatry is probably highly rationalized when it happens. He probably even looked at it and said, well, this is just symbolic because God's obviously on the mountain, but this is the God. Here it is. But what they didn't realize that what they were doing is that oftentimes when the Lord comes, we get afraid. And when people are afraid, they begin to worship their past victories, and they worship what the Lord has accomplished instead of what the Lord is actively saying and doing. And so when the Lord came, they responded in fear because that's some scary looking stuff there. I mean, you did just see the ocean split and the firstborns of Egypt all taken by the angel of death, so you'd think that they'd be like, oh, yeah, well, that's how God is. But no, I don't think so. I don't think it ever gets old to behold the Lord in that way. And so the Lord came, and they responded in fear, and they worshiped what the Lord had done. What can that look like now? That can look like worshiping God and hoping he shows up in the way that he did 10 years ago for you. Or hoping that the Lord would show up in the way that he did financially breakthrough for you, that you would give through this person or that same route. Because somehow, and I'll tell you why, because sometimes when there's an absence of relationship with the Lord, when there's an absence of connection with the Lord, we go to structures, we go to rhythms and paths that worked in the past. Because instead of hanging on to the living, breathing life of God coming from the throne, we start to look at the routes and the roads that were created from his voice and say that if we walk in these, maybe if we walk in these, we'll get the same result without the connection, and that we won't have to wait and be in faith because we know what to do. And I got to tell you that we're entering a season where the Lord is going to visit us in a completely new way, and it's not going to look like it has before. And if we could be a church that I believe that we are, which is a church that embraces the Lord and all that he is and says, Lord, however you would like to show up, whatever you'd like to do in this moment, we are all in as a church, as a body. We want to go with you. We want to go with you. We want to go with you. Lord, we don't want to be hung up in the past and worship what you've done or talk about this amazing conference you did here or there, or how you use us here or there. We want to live off of the word of God. When Jesus was tempted by the devil, he came and he said, turn these stones into bread. And what did Jesus say? He said, man doesn't live by bread alone, but by in every word that was, that is, and is proceeding out of the mouth of God. We live on the word, and that's why you're here, is because you believe that God speaks, and we live on his breath, and we believe there's an active partnership between God and the earth, that the Spirit of God wants to move in power and in healing and touch lives and to use you to do it. That's why you're here, even if you don't know it yet. It's because the Lord has something for you. And you can look all through Scripture. You can look at Solomon when he offered 1,000 burnt offerings and the Lord showed up and said, have anything you want. And Solomon said, just give me wisdom to lead. And then after that dream and God gave him that supernatural wisdom, they opened the temple after it was finished, and the Spirit of God came so heavily that the priests couldn't continue in their services. Can you imagine what that was like when the glory of God descended on those people? Amazing. I think that's where we're headed. I think that's where we're going. We're coming together. And do we know how to treat him when he comes? I'm going to close with this. We recognize him for who he is with awareness of his continual presence in our lives. And I believe that that can be a way to explain what worship is. It's recognizing God in our every moment as Lord. You know, I was listening to Jesus Image, and Michael Koulianos was talking about prayer. He said, if prayer was only a request and we're commanded to pray without ceasing, then how do we have a job? How do we parent? How do we serve? You know, that limits prayer to just a request. And if worship is only songs, then aren't we limiting worship to the tiniest portion of our time and lives? Shouldn't worship just be our lives? Our life should be worship unto the Lord. You know, from signs and wonders and miracles to the normal everyday, our lives are worship when we continually recognize God for who he actually is and how we honor that revelation that his Spirit lives in us right now. Could you stand on your feet for a moment? Just put your hand over your stomach right there. You know, when in 2 Chronicles, it's just such a beautiful verse. It says when Solomon finished praying, this is 2 Chronicles 7:7, fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offering and the sacrifices. And the glory of the Lord filled the temple. And the priests couldn't enter the house of the Lord because the glory of God had filled the Lord's house. And when all the children of Israel saw how fire came down and the glory of the Lord on the temple, they bowed their faces to the ground on the pavement and worshiped and praised, saying, the Lord is good and his mercy endures forever. So would you just lift your hands? Lord, we declare this morning, you are good. And your mercy endures forever. Lord, would you find a people who recognize you for who you are? Lord, that when you walk into the room, that we're not eager to move on, or we're so enamored by the things that you're doing or the power that you're moving in, that, Lord, we look to what you've breathed on instead of where the breath is coming from. Lord, we look to you. We look to you. We look to you. And I prophesy over this congregation, I prophesy that the encounters with the Lord that you're about to experience will eclipse and supersede everything that you've encountered before. That the high water, I feel like the Lord said that the bar is about to change. The watermark is about to be raised, that the way he intends to show up in this place and in your life is going to set a new standard for how he moves, that it's going to set a new standard in you, that some of you here today, you're going to discover that God moves in ways that you never anticipated. He's going to surprise you. Even those who have seen so much and experienced so much, he's going to surprise you. It's going to be shocking. It's going to blow your mind with the lavish, extravagant goodness and kindness of the Lord. When you start to see the family members that you believe are unreachable come back, when you start to see the people that you thought would never respond, and all of a sudden these altars aren't just filled with us as a family, it's an expanding kingdom of people who are surrendering their lives to the Lord, embracing the gospel and transforming their city. All of a sudden we are part of something that's so much bigger than ourselves. And Lord, I just bless these people this morning. Bethel Cleveland, I bless you to receive that. I bless you that the Lord is about to come, and when he comes, we want to be ready to treat him with the honor and worship and praise that he's worthy of. We're setting a table for the King. Lord, let our lives be the meal. Lord, let our lives be the meal, that we would set the table with our very lives. Let our lives be worship, Lord, that our laid down lives and sacrifice before you would tempt you, would entice you, and that your spirit would come and transform all of us, Lord, that you'd make us more hungry and more dependent on you than we've ever been, that we might see the stories that are written about now at Azusa Street, God, that we might see the stories about the revivals that have happened, Lord, happened here, that we would be telling, that one day we'd be those 90-year-olds in those chairs talking about the glory of God that came and telling stories about how you moved in power and eagerly looking to the future for when you'll do it again. Lord, let that be our legacy, that we would be hungry for the presence of God all the days of our life, and that you would bless everyone here today with a deeper hunger than what they've experienced even yet. Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, we need you. We need you. We invite you. I'm going to invite our ministry teams to come forward. And Angela, I think Angela's coming up with me.
Yeah, I'm right here.
Awesome. Angela, I feel like we should prophesy and pray for just a moment. And then, you know, obviously after I head off to Middleburg, you can continue with whatever the Lord gives you. But our ministry teams are lining up across the front, and I just want to invite you, if you'd like to respond to this, if you'd like to, even if it's just, I'm saying yes to the next season, and I need a breakthrough in the Lord, or I'm saying yes to the reset of my bar for the watermark of my Christianity, for my encounters with the Lord, I want you to come up to the front, and we're going to pray and bless you, and we'll just wait here for a moment while you make your way. You won't miss it in your seats, I promise. But if you want to come to the front, I feel like the Lord is going to do something special for people who are hungry for what the Lord might do. If you really need a breakthrough, a touch in your life and your body today, I want to invite you to come to the front. And then I just want to pray one more time, and I'm going to pass it off to Angela. She's going to minister to you. But Bethel Cleveland, Lord, I pray, I thank you for your presence. Holy Spirit, I thank you for your presence in our lives today. And I bless this room. I pray that you would just bring hearts into the kingdom. Even those today who may not know you, Father, I pray that you would pull them in. God, I pray that there would be the open wide door for salvation offered, and they would take it. And Lord, I pray, lastly, Lord, that you would just fill this place with hope and anticipation that the King is coming, and that when we come together, he will come. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yeah, so just continue to receive up front. And if you want like personal prayer, you can come up to one of our ministry team members for some personal prayer as well. And I just love how Jay was talking about, I just heard just so much of like the intimacy of the Father and of Jesus, just knowing us and us knowing him, and we don't have to wait for that to happen. And I felt too, like for Ethan's Crossing, who's live streaming with us, if you don't know, we have an amazing rehabilitation center that we have ministered at, Kim Snyder and her team, and they live stream with us. And I love that they're there. And we say, welcome, you guys can wave back at them. But we don't have to wait until we make ourselves better. We don't have to wait until this hard season has passed to experience the intimacy of the Lord, to know him. Like the testimony of Jesus is a spirit of prophecy. So we read about Moses and okay, Lord, then I want what he had. I want this closeness with you like he had. We read about David having a heart, just his heart being after God's heart, and we can have that now. You don't have to wait. What we do need is to surrender. So you don't have to wait to get better, to be better, to have a closer relationship. You just surrender and say, Jesus, here I am. So if you have never surrendered your life to Jesus, now is the time. Knowing him is not a sin management program, it's a freedom program. And he, as you invite him in, he changes our lives. You don't have to be perfect. He is perfect and he becomes perfect in us. So Lord, we just thank you. Lord, we thank you for what you're doing today, God. Thank you for stirring hearts to know you more. Jesus, we just want to know you more, God. And we just lay everything down that we feel like is keeping us from being close to you, and we recognize the truth that you are already closer. If we are believers and we've accepted you in our lives, Jesus, you are closer than our skin. And so we recognize your closeness. Yeah, and ministry team, if you're not praying for someone, go ahead and just lay hands on people who are up here and just minister to them however you feel led. We thank you, Jesus. And I just wanted to say to who's ever watching from that treatment center that you are not alone. You have an entire congregation here who is praying for you, who is interceding for you, who is believing in you, that you are not missing out because you are not physically here. The Lord is there. He is touching you. I feel like there's someone with something with their wrist. That the Lord just wants to heal that and show you that he is present for you, that he is for you, that some of you are going to become like Paul's where you feel like you're in a prison, but yet everything gets set on revival where you're at. You don't have to wait to be out of that place for him to bring revival to where you're at. So we just bless you with revival in that treatment center. We just thank you, Jesus. We thank you for them. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you, Lord. You guys are free to just continue to receive up here. There's no rush. Let me just bless you all with just experiencing Jesus this week in the ordinary things of life. Invite him into the ordinary. You'll see every day will become supernatural for you. So we bless you and just release you to have a wonderful day.